reality of television should be brought up. It's too powerful a medium. Too many people watch it. Too many people spend time in front of it. And for the good of all of us, we have to find some way that that we can make it better. And I don't mean that we necessarily, that doesn't necessarily mean more earnest. And that doesn't necessarily mean more solemn. And that doesn't mean Shakespeare. Those things which are calculated to be entertainment can be entertainment, but they can be a higher form of entertainment. But the general level of mediocrity is overwhelming, I think. That's the impression that I get from the little that I see of it.
In your experience as an actor and just being around television for so long, have you ever zeroed in on any kind of reasons why that is true?
Money. Money. There's only one reason, money. It's the only reason. I mean, everybody's caught up in the race for money.
And that's it. Good night.
It's time for a commercial speech.
What do you think of the richer flavor we put into new Purina Dog Chow?
The new richer flavor. Superb.
Wunderbar. Tastes better than the old Dog Chow.
Tastes great. What does it look like?
Lots of flavor for a wee bit of money.
This is dog food's finest hour.
It makes me very happy.
The new taste is muy bueno.
Dogs love it because each nugget is basted with richer flavor. Introducing new, richer tasting dog chow.
Yago Sangria time. Time for the party wine from Spain. Pour it over ice or serve it chilled and just add people because Yago makes it a party wherever you are. Rich red Spanish wine, pre-mixed with the juices of Spain's magnificent citrus fruits. Yago Sangria, for the fun of it.
Jones fully cooked minute breakfast sausage. Just heat it and eat it. Jones minute breakfast sausage, no artificial ingredients.
KNXT Channel 2.
Because of the special program, tonight CBS late, 30 minutes later than usual, at 12 o'clock, 11 Central Time.
Edward Kennedy Ellington played the piano, wrote music like no other music, and had a band that sounded like no other band. Music that, as one of his sidemen said, made a swimming in your head. Duke Ellington died of cancer and pneumonia today. He was 75. This is a small tribute to him.
This is a CBS News special report. A tribute to Duke Ellington. This broadcast is sponsored by Renews It Air Freshener. The aerosol spray that never comes on too strong.
The boss is going to be here and the house smells of fried fish.
Your boss loves it.
But to eat, not to smell.
Don't worry. Renews It spray takes the worry out of household odors instantly.
We're expecting big things from you, Henry, in your new job. Sarah, your fried fish.
Oh. My cooking got you the job.
My talent. With a little help from Renews It.
Renews It Spray Air Freshener takes the worry out of household odors instantly.
Here he is. Come on, let's go. Come on. And your only business is growing roses? I couldn't get a thing out of you. I'll get him at the courthouse.
Is the Swiss bank account for your rose business?
But wait a minute, what about...
Even when you can't hold up any longer, your hair can with Final Knit. It's not an aerosol hairspray. It's Clairol's Clear Mist you spritz on once to hold three times longer than the best-selling hairspray. Final Knit holds up longer than you do.
Good night, Frank. Good night, Jessica.
Jessica?
Duke Ellington liked to say that loves came and went, but music was his mistress. and she stayed on. He took her everywhere. He never stopped writing and playing and traveling. We're going to listen to his music from a trip to Japan in 1964. That was Duke Ellington in public, the one his friends saw when we come back.
When a man uses an aftershave, what does he really want?
Fancy bottles?
Full of fancy perfume?
At fancy prices?
No!
A man wants to smell like a man.
There's something about Aqua Velva.
He wants to be cool and refreshed.
There's something about Aqua Velva.
A man wants to feel like a man.
Feel like a man.
Cause there's something about an Aqua Velva man.
Jim, when you were completely gray, you did look much older. You look so much better with just a touch of gray.
Grecian Formula 16. It's practically clear. As easy to use as water. No mess. Use it every day until you slowly, gradually get rid of just as much gray as you want. Some of it, most of it, or all of it. Then once a week or so to keep it that way.
I use Lady Grecian Formula, and he doesn't even know it.
Grecian Formula 16 and Lady Grecian Formula.
In the early years, it was black man's music played for white people at the Cotton Club in Harlem, in movie shorts like this one made in 1933. From the beginning, Duke Ellington was an elegant man. That's why they called him Duke. "I'm a piano player," Duke said, "an underrated one, perhaps because he was much more. A band leader, of course, and a composer. Primitive stuff," as he said, "like New Orleans Lowdown and Cincinnati Daddy. Short songs like Sophisticated Lady and Black Butterfly. Hit parade tunes like I Got It Bad and That Ain't Good and Don't Get Around Much Anymore. Suites and symphonies. And in later years, religious music, the sacred concerts. In the sacred music," he said, "he could say out loud what he'd been saying on his knees." He stopped using the word jazz 30 years ago. Music was too precious to be described, whatever its form. What Duke Ellington did was write about love and about God and about being black, scribbling it down on a piece of paper and playing it back through horns and reeds and strings. No piano player did it better. Some friends and colleagues of Duke Ellington were kind enough to come by and share their thoughts with us tonight. Sonny Greer, the drummer who goes back to the very beginning, 1921, right?
Right.
And Russell Prokop, alto saxophonist and clarinetist, who came along a little later. I think it was 1945, was it?
46.
46?
Yes.
Stayed. Billy Taylor, pianist, entrepreneur, and man of all jazz. And Stanley Dance, jazz critic and historian, who was a friend of Duke Ellington for some 40 years. Let's begin with you, Sonny, and go down the line and ask each of you to give us a reminiscence of a time with Duke Ellington that tells us who the man was.
Well, I tell you, John, Duke was a guy I met many years ago, and it's the first time I seen Duke. He just had that personality that when you knew Duke, and we later years, we had a saying, to know you is to love you, and I know you. That was, we coined that phrase. Duke was the guy, and I never forget, he was just outstanding. I don't know what it is. You know, you see a person that can walk in a room and light up the whole place, you know. That's how he affected me. But I never tell him, you know. And I never tell him. They say many years ago when I was a kid that a thoroughbred is born. You don't make a thoroughbred. That's all I can say, my friend, about my boy, you know? That's all I can say.
From working in the band, I would say what it has to do with the personnel in the band, I would say that as he was a giant with a pencil and paper, he would put it down on that paper for you. And in his writing and composing, he bore in mind who he was doing this for. That's why I used to say, the band is my instrument, see? He didn't just write anything at all off the top of his head and just put it out there for you to play. what he wrote, he was very cognizant of who he was writing for.
And that was?
Each man in the band. Whoever it was.
It varied.
That's right.
He had one kind of person.
That's right.
He wrote one
That's
way.
Right.
He wrote
right.
had another
right.
kind.
Whoever it might be. Sure.
So Duke really took all of the elements that go into black music and fused them into something which is a very positive statement. And he transcended. One of the reasons he objected to music being called jazz was that he transcended what the common concept of jazz was. And he wanted people to be aware of that. Because his idea of music was, there is something that I'm saying to you musically, which is religious, if that's what I have in mind. It's beautiful, if that's what I have in mind. It's sophisticated, if that's what I have in mind. It's full of guts and it's raucous. And he had all of the human qualities that make great art. But he put them into a very special perspective that, to me, epitomizes the best in American music.
There's no one in the world ever wrote harmony like Duke. Duke could write a chord, an ordinary chord, which would be voiced by anybody else, you know, like a brass, you know, for the brass, you know. And you'd hear it, you know. You'd say, wow. And for someone to sit down and just copy it, they couldn't do it. Now, from time to time, we'd had people who would come into the band, like a saxophone player. He'd sit next to me, he's filling in that particular night. He'd say, oh, this is the wrong note here, and he'd get ready to check. I said, no. And leave that just the way it is. That's not wrong. That's right. Yeah, sure. So after he played it, if he was there, say, a week, then after he'd say, oh, yes, oh, I can hear it now, you know.
Well, I think that the musicians naturally have covered the musical aspects of Duke Ellington very well. For myself, one of the things that always delighted me was his ironic sense of humor under the most adverse circumstances. For instance, last October, he gave his third sacred concert at Westminster Abbey, and he was exhausted before it began, and it was bitterly cold. And I went backstage afterwards, and he was lying in bed, and everybody was sitting around, very gloomy. And there was a party at the Prime Minister's house, and Duke was saying that he felt too ill to go. And I said, well, you've got to go, because Princess Margaret will be there. And he said, that's right. And he said, all the hospitals are full. So we went.
He worked hard, didn't they?
Oh, yes, he worked very hard.
Very hard.
He worked hard and he played hard.
It's,
yeah.
Duke was, I never in my life seen a man, the original Ellington organization, we had 12, and each one of us was an individual star, and nobody played the same way. They were individuals, you know? Duke could look at you and say, hey, play me so-and-so. Play me four choruses of this. And they could go down and play their interpretation. And then they would come back to the bandstand, and as a team, you never heard nothing like it in your life, because it was level. I mean, you know what I mean? Level. And I never seen a man could take 12 individual stars and wheel them, you know, into a team.
Billy, you indicated that he was racially conscious in much of his music.
Looking at the things that he wrote and what they meant to him, he wrote about things that were that had to do with his heritage. He wrote about things which had to do with the way he felt about this country, about the way he felt about the people in it. And he was very much aware of the opinions of people. He had, in his early days, because of prejudice, he couldn't stay in many of the places. So he had his own Pullman car, and he would go into a city, and they couldn't stay in the hotel, so they'd stay in the Pullman car. And here's a man who is acknowledged a great artist by kings and queens, and in his own country, he's treated as less than a human being. And so his music reflected the fact that he didn't think this was the proper course to take. And he did it in his usual elegant way, and he did it in a very elegant way. And rather than the clenched fist approach,
presented his feeling in a very, very positive way. And I think that in retrospect, when one looks at his work, we'll find a tremendous line that goes from those early days of Black Beauty and the things that he wrote for the Cotton Club, where he was talking to a predominantly white audience and saying, hey, this is something you should be aware of. This is not just jungle music. This is excellent artistic presentation, and it's something very special which you should listen carefully to.
Ellington wrote music nearly every day of his life. You know how it is, he said. You go home expecting to go right to bed, but then on the way, you go past the piano and there's a flirtation. It flirts with you. So you sit down and try out a couple of chords, and when you look up, it's 7 a.m.
I'm so glad you called, honey.
I just had to tell you what a wonderful time we had, Mama.
Well, we loved having you both.
And Mama, I want to thank you for telling Tom about Sominex. It really helped him.
Well, Sominex does help when you sometimes have trouble falling asleep.
I did just like you said. Helped make him drowsy so he could get to sleep.
With a lot less trouble thanks to you.
Oh, Tom, thanks to Sominex.
Sominex. It helps take the trouble out of falling asleep.
When you come right down to it, most of us are just too busy to spend much time learning everything we need to know about life insurance. That's why I'm glad I talked to a Northwestern man. He really explained life insurance to me. And when I asked a question, I got a straight answer. It's easy to understand why the Northwestern is the seventh largest life insurance company in America. Just talking to a Northwestern man is time well spent.
Northwestern Mutual Life, the quiet company people have been talking about for over 100 years.
Finally, Ella Fitzgerald is here for a tribute to Duke Ellington. What kind of a man was he?
Oh, it's hard to describe him. He was the kind of a man that I don't think there's anyone who ever could say anything bad, or he ever said anything bad about anybody. He always had a happy smile, whether he was tired, sleepy, you never knew it because it always was that smile and that chewing of the gum that he always had, and some little sophisticated phrase that he would use to say something to you that kept you from even feeling bad if you felt bad.
On your tours with him, what sort of traveler was he?
He was amazing. He was like a superman. We couldn't understand it. We would be tired sometimes, and we'd get through with a concert, and everybody was just waiting to get to the hotel so we could eat and go to bed, you know? And you'd look up, and if there's a piano around, Duke would go to the piano and start playing. And we would say, my gosh, how does he do it? And he'd be smiling, and he'd start playing, and then everybody would get around the piano and start listening to him, and he would start composing music, and you'd go to bed, and sometimes you'd get up in the morning to catch the plane, and you'd see somebody's over in a little studio or something writing music, and you said, did you get some sleep? He said, oh, I'll get it on a plane. And when we'd get on the plane, he'd conk out from about, if the plane ride was about a half hour, he'd sleep, and you say, how can he go to sleep so fast, you know? And he'd wake up, and he's ready to go again. Just amazing.
Your music is your music, and his music was his music.
Right.
But you got together. How did that work?
Because Duke was the type of man, the music that he wrote, it was the kind of music that anybody could sing and anybody could hum.
Would you finish our broadcast of tributes tonight with a tribute of your own? A song, perhaps?
Oh, this, there are so many of his songs that I love. This one I love, and it's one of my favorites. It was called, As I Walk Down the Street, seems everyone I meet gives me a friendly hello. I guess I'm just a lucky so-and-so. Yes, a lucky so-and-so. And we were very lucky to have known a genius, a man who could write so much music, so much talent. and to be a part of this music that he wrote, and to have known such a beautiful man. You very seldom call a man beautiful, but he was beautiful.
Last year, there was a television broadcast that honored Duke Ellington, and at the end, he came on it to tell his life story.
Once upon a time, a very pretty lady and a very, very handsome gentleman fell in love and got married, and God blessed them with this wonderful baby boy. And of course, they loved this little baby boy. They raised him, spoiled him, nurtured him, you know, just raised him in the palm of the hand. And actually, they let his feet touch the ground until he was about 8 years old. And finally, when he did get out on the ground, what did he do? He rushed out the front door. Incidentally, the lovely little baby boy was me. So he ran out the front door, across the front lawn, across the street, and when he got to the other side, somebody says, "Hey, Edward, turn left, right up that way." So when he gets up to the corner, somebody says, "Edward, take a right hand here and go up there." And when he gets to the next corner, somebody says, "Hey, Edward, take a left hand, go around the circle, cut across the park, straight ahead, you can't miss it." And that's the way my whole thing has been going all my life. That's my life story. So, as you see, it's a very simple story. Only problem is, it's all these wonderful people I have to remember who were standing on these various corners, who very, very conveniently says, "Edward, this way, take right, left, U-turn, etc., etc., and into love you madly."
This has been a CBS News special report, a tribute to Duke Ellington.